The greatest power you will ever experience is the power of God's love towards you.
Death has been defined, and the grave has been denied.
The gospel of Jesus Christ does not revolve around your love and commitment towards God, but it revolves around God's love and commitment towards you.
Now, what a relief, forgiven and free.
God is not a sin-conscious God, but a worth-conscious God. And you are worth so much to Him. The following program revolves around God's love for you, when you can discover your worth and enjoy the life God has dreamt for you. It's such a blessing for me to come and bring you the message of God's grace, the message of the mercy and the kindness of God, wherein God looks at you favorably, wherein He is discovered as a God that is not sin conscious or works conscious or obligation conscious, but that He's value conscious and that He's come to save you from what kills and destroys you. A message wherein Jesus Christ is the center of it all, wherein it is all about what He has come and brought forth in the earth through His obedience on behalf of all people. I am Bertie Brits, and it's an honor for me today to speak to you about the curse, or what we have called the curse, that would come until the third and fourth generation. And I'm going to talk about it in the light of God's grace, and I'm going to show to you from the scripture in the next two programs that whole concept of God visiting the sins until the third and fourth generation, wherein He would just go about punishing people and keeping people sin against them for what their father, grandfather, or great-grandfather has done, that it is all not true. And that is actually this whole concept about visiting the sins until the third and fourth generation of those that hate God or those that are against God is actually talking about the goodness and the kindness of God towards people that are against Him. That is what we're going to look at. So I trust this is going to bless you. You know, many times we've come to a place where we think, you know what, if my great-grandfather sinned, maybe that's why I struggle. Or if my great-grandfather had cancer, that's why I can have cancer and he can. You know, we've got this whole thing about sin confession, whole thing about such a sin consciousness, where we actually think that God would destroy nations and God would be against countries because of what their great-grandfathers did or grandfathers did or fathers did. What kind of a being would keep sin against somebody until the third and fourth generation? If I do that, it would be called unforgiveness. It would be called harshness. It would be called anti-God or against the very nature and love of God. Imagine I go around in the earth and if somebody has harmed my great-grandfather, then I would go about beating up on the great-grandchildren, you know, and just beat up on them because of what was done by people that lived 100 years ago. I mean, that just doesn't sound right, does it? But yet, we have believed that that is what God does. And I want to explain to you today that that is not what God does. And like I said, this is going to be a two-part series. In the first part, I'm going to explain just who God is and how kind He is and how good He is. And in next week's service, we're going to go more in depth explaining exactly how this whole thing works. So make sure that you listen to both sessions, because if you don't listen to both sessions, you will get half a truth. You will not see it in the light of the original intent when it was written in the Bible. So what's very important is that we always look at Jesus Christ and what He has done before we conclude our doctrine. You know, when Jesus walked on the earth, when He looked at kids, I never see Jesus going to a child of 5 years old and just slap him. And then if somebody says, "Jesus, what are you doing?" And then Jesus would say, Well, you didn't know his great-grandfather, and I'm here to be a perfect representation of the father. So I'm going to start a beat up on kids, and don't hinder them from coming to me, because if I need to dish out the third and fourth generation slaps, I'm going to do it. I mean, we don't see Jesus doing something like that. So why can we come? And because the Father is unseen and we don't see the Father in physical form, why would we ascribe a horrible thing to God like Him beating up on children when the great-grandfather committed a sin? Imagine Jesus walking up to a child and slapping him and saying to him, that was because your great-grandfather committed adultery. Imagine that. And imagine Jesus saying, well, I am not forgiving anybody here unless there's a group of people, or unless my disciples confesses the sin of this nation before me. If they don't do that, then I will not forgive this nation. I'm here to bring vengeance and the wrath of God on this nation to destroy it. We don't see Jesus doing that. We never see Jesus doing that. We can actually never even imagine that Jesus would ever do such a thing. Yet, the moment He went into the cloud, or into heaven, went into a different dimension in His glorified state, and we cannot physically see Him right now, we ascribe anything to the unseen God, and we would say, you know, any horrible thing is because of Him. And then we've got some scripture that we quote, and we will quote the law. We will quote Exodus, the law, where we would say, this is if you don't obey the law. Don't bring any false gods before me, because, you know, I am a jealous God and I will visit the sins of the, you know, and it just explains, you know, we read that and we take it right into the New Testament. Never apply the cross, never apply what Jesus Christ has done for us and what He came and revealed about the Father and about us. We never apply any of that. And that just brings so much misery and horror into the church and leaves us at a place where we cannot really trust and believe God. Who of you would ever trust and believe in a being that beats up on children until the third and fourth generation? Nobody. Nobody can, from the depth of his heart, trust such a person with his life or the life of his children. Now, the title of this message, I've titled this way, it is The Third and Fourth Generation, The Lovely Visit of God. And then I want to read from Exodus 33 and verse 18. It reads as follows. It says, and he said, I beseech you, show me your glory. And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before you, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before you, and will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will show mercy unto whom I will show mercy. I want you to look at what I've got there in verse 19. It says there, I will make all my goodness pass before you. I will make all my goodness pass before you and proclaim the name of the Lord. Now, Moses, this is an encounter that Moses had with God. And he was on the mountain and he basically just said to God, God, show me your glory. Now, what's very significant about that is that Moses saw the mountain that shook. He heard the audible voice of God. He stood in the cloud full of glory. And in the midst of all of that, he comes and he says, would you please show me your glory? And by saying that, he says that the fire, the manifested fire, the smoke, the audible voice, the feeling of the presence of God, that it is not the glory of God. Because why would you ask God to show you His glory if you are already seeing the glory cloud, and if that was the glory? If the fire was the glory, if the cloud was the glory, if the audible voice was the glory, if the physical presence that shakes the mountain was the glory of God, I would think Moses would have said, thank you that you have shown me your glory, for your glory is this fire and this cloud and all these kind of things. But Moses comes Well, God comes to Moses and he says to Moses, okay, I will show you my glory. And then he defines what the glory is. He says, I will let all my goodness pass before you. Isn't that absolutely amazing? God comes and he defines his glory as his goodness. He defines his glory as his goodness. Now, we're going to pick it up from Exodus 34 verse 6 where this encounter takes place. Now, Exodus 34 verse 6 reads like this. It says, and the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed or introduced himself. He said, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity, transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the father upon the children's children until the third and fourth generation. And Moses made haste and bowed his head towards the earth and worshipped. And he said, if now I have found grace in your sight, O Lord, let my Lord, I pray you, go amongst us, for it is a stiff-necked people, and pardon our iniquity and our sin, and take us for your inheritance. I want us to just read verse 6 again. It says, and the Lord passed before him, and he proclaimed or introduced himself, and he said, I am the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth. Now, when we look at God introducing himself here, it's basically God coming and he's saying to Moses, Moses, I just want to greet you. This is who I am. You know, this is who I am. I am merciful. I am gracious. You've met graciousness now. You've met mercy now. You've, Moses, here I am. You know, I am kindness. I keep mercy for thousands. I visit iniquity. This is who I am. And I see this friendly guy with his hand sticking out introducing himself. That is what took place there. God came and he introduced himself to Moses. That is what took place. And we're going to look at the first word there where it says merciful. And I'm going to just look at it from the original language and what it means. This is what it means. It's the word compassionate. It says compassion, suffering with another, painful sympathy, a sensation of sorrow excited by the distress or misfortune of another. It's suffering with another, painful sympathy, a sensation of sorrow excited by distress or misfortune of another. Now, when God comes and introduces him to Moses, the first thing that he says is, he says, listen, I just want to tell you straight out, I am compassion. And don't you think it is misfortune if one man, Adam, disobeys God and brings absolute distress and misery unto the whole earth? Don't you think that's misfortune? It's absolute misfortune. It is not what God intended for man, and he really feels sorry for man. He feels pity. He really has what you call a painful sympathy. So when God introduced him to Moses, he said to Moses, Moses, what this is about is I've got a painful sympathy for you. I've got so much sympathy for you that the very core of my being, the womb of Yahweh, moves with compassion. Now, doesn't that immediately remove all guilt and all hurt and all pain and all fear and all distress that there would be in a person and put him at ease and make him feel comfortable? I want to say to you, if God had to come and introduce himself to you, the first thing that he would want you to understand and the foundation from where you understand the glory of God, and this is the glory of God, God's glory is how compassionate he is. How he's got a painful, this is what it says here, a painful sympathy, a sensation of sorrow excited by the distress or the misfortune of another. So God looks at you and he says, it's unfortunate, it is a misfortune, it is a distress that is upon the people, on the Israelites, or I mean just on people, and God feels our pain. I want to say to you, when many times we think God feels our pain only when we have cancer or when we've got something bad, but I want to tell you, if you are bound in sin, if you are bound in pornography, if you are bound in stealing, theft, whatever it could be, hatred, bitterness, God doesn't look at you with less sympathy than what He would look at somebody's child that was born with cancer, or what He would look at somebody that was hit by a car and is paralyzed. He is equally, he's got equal pain. You know, when I see somebody, if I look at my child and imagine my child is hooked on drugs, would you not have sympathy? Would that not bring pain to your heart when you so much want him free? You're not going to be, if he is hooked on drugs, or if he has got some form of thing that he just cannot control, is there not a form of sympathy with that person? And I've seen it many times, if in counseling and in speaking with people, if somebody's child has harmed your child, then you would be upset with that child and you have sympathy with your child. But if your child is the bully, then you will have sympathy on your child. Now, how much more God? Here he comes and he says, and he introduces himself as the God that has got sympathy, that has compassion. Compassion is such a powerful word that it cannot be explained just in English. It actually talks about the very depth of God starting to move and bringing creation into a move of restoration, because he feels with us. So when God comes and he shows his glory, he comes and he says, I want to tell you, Moses, the first thing that I want you to know about me is that I am compassionate. I feel with you and I feel with these people. You know what's the most amazing thing about God when he said this? While he said this, the people that he felt compassion for was busy building a golden calf. And God knew that, because God is all-knowing. He knew that. And he came and he spoke to Moses. And he said to Moses, Moses, I want to tell you, come and let me show you who I am. And since you've asked me to show you my glory, I want to say to you that I can feel with you. I feel with you. I've got a sensation that of sorrow. I feel sorrowful, and this is excited by the distress and the misfortune of people. You know, it's a misfortune to be in a place where you're so under laws, rules, and regulations that and where you are so afraid of God that you feel that you cannot come close to Him. You know, it's a misfortune when you think of God as a God that will just punish children because of parents. That's misfortune. It's sad. It's sad. And we need to have a new understanding, and we need to have a greater view about who God is about that. And God looks at mankind in the earth, and they think, and He sees how they think that He visits sin. In other words, He's going to beat up on people until the third and fourth generation. We see Jesus coming on the earth, never slapping any kids whatsoever. He never, ever, not once is it ever recorded, and it is impossible for Jesus, when he was upon the earth, to cause death to come to people or to cause punishment to come to people because of other people's sin. And the Bible says the soul that sins shall die. It does not say, you know, that the children will die because of the parents. That is a wicked way of thinking about God. We should never think about God that way. Many times we think if we break the third and fourth, the curse until the third and fourth generation, you know, then God can come and visit us and be compassionate to us. No, God has got compassion upon people. God has got compassion upon people. He is good to people. He loves people. Glory to God. Now, many times we think that God would just come and if somebody has sinned, he will wipe out a whole city because of one person's sin. Makes me think of New Orleans, you know, when people said, you know, the judgment of God came upon New Orleans and in the flood Katrina. And you know what? The whole place flooded except Bourbon Street. It's amazing. It's amazing. Bourbon Street, the place which is the nest of all sin, didn't flood. but many preachers' houses flooded, many churches flooded, so many things flooded. And we want to think it's God visiting sin in that way. That's not how God visits sin. Let me give you a hint on how God visits sin. When God visits sin, He took sin away. He came and He brought mercy and kindness, and He visits it with kindness. So before we come to any conclusion on how God visits sin, we must realize that God is compassionate. Second word I want to look at there is the word gracious. The word gracious means kindness, and this is what it is, goodwill, benevolence, the temperance or disposition which delights in contributing to the happiness of others, which is exercised cheerfully in gratifying their wishes, supplying their wants, and alleviating or lifting their distresses. Benignity of nature, kindness ever accompanies love. I want to just focus on this. It says here, it is a kindness or a disposition which delight in contributing to the happiness of others. Glory to God. So God comes and He introduces Him to Moses. Moses, I am the one that feels with the pain of the people, and I am here, and I happily want to contribute to lifting their distresses. I am a kind person. I am full of kindness. I've got the disposition or the personality that would delight in contributing to your happiness. That is what He is saying. He wants to contribute to happiness. Glory to God. The word kindness, if we look at the next slide there that I want to quickly look at, the word kindness here also means to bow. It's also the word for mercy, a root word. The root word of kindness there, or goodness, says abundant in goodness. So He's compassionate, gracious, abundant in goodness. The word goodness there, another word for kindness, means to bow the neck humbly to an equal. Okay, to be kind. So what God says here, He says that I am the Lord God. I am merciful. I'm gracious. I'm long-suffering. I'm abundant in goodness and truth. You know, when the Bible says God is long-suffering, it means He's not easily offended at somebody doing something wrong. So many times we think that if we're just in the right moment of worship and we do something wrong, this presence is going to leave because there's sin in the camp. That's rubbish. I want to tell you straight out, people, that is not the truth. If sin could cause God to leave the camp, Jesus could never have come to the earth. Because how would He come to the earth and actually become sin? It is impossible. So we see here that the Bible says God is compassionate. The compassionate there means to painful sympathy. He is gracious. Gracious there means to have the character that delights in contributing to the happiness of others. He is long-suffering, meaning He will continue in that state and He cannot easily change. He cannot change from that. And then He's abundant in goodness and truth. The word goodness there means to bow the neck in courtesy to an equal, meaning I honor you as my equal. So God comes and He says, listen, I want to introduce myself. I am kindness. I am goodness, and I will never forget who you are, and I honor you as my kind. That is how He introduces Himself to Moses. And the last word that I'm going to look at there is the word truth. He says He is abundant in goodness and truth. And let's read the word truth there. Truth there means stability, certainty, truth, trustworthiness. Now, isn't that powerful? I want to look at the word trustworthiness there. Isn't that powerful? When we look at the meaning of the word truth means trustworthiness or stability. So I want to end off by saying this to you. When we look at God visiting the sins of the people in the third and fourth generation, as a foundation which we've laid in this service, on this message, we have to conclude that God is truthful. He is truthful. He will stay the way He is. So, when we say that God is a God that introduces Himself and say, I want to shake your hand, Moses. This is who I am. I am merciful, gracious, long-suffering, abundant in goodness and truth. And as we've defined all of these words, we know that He is full of trustworthiness and stability. He is not going to change. So we cannot all of a sudden say that when God visits the sin until the third and fourth generation, that all of these character traits of God is now all of a sudden going to fall out of the bus. God will still be the God of compassion when he visits sin. He's not going to visit sin with anger now. He's going to visit sin with compassion. He will still visit sin with kindness. He will still visit sin with goodness. He will still be the true God that cannot change. Glory to God. Now, isn't that absolutely powerful? Hallelujah. I would love to pray for you right now. Maybe you're going through difficult times. Maybe you're feeling, God, why are all these things going wrong with me? Maybe it's some sin that I've done wrong and now you cannot bless me. I would like to pray for you because that is simply not the truth. If you have sin, God will visit you. And what he will visit you with is absolute compassion, because his heart pains because he sees sin is destructive and he wants a new life for you. Let us pray together. Father, I want to thank you that I can stretch forth my hand to people that are watching, and I thank you that you bring a new life to them in a new understanding wherein who you are and who they are is put on display in the love of Jesus Christ when he came and took away the sin of the whole world, bringing innocence to every man. Amen. I would like to encourage you to contact us. Please go to our website, dynamicministries.com, and just click on Contact Us, and we would love to hear from you. Please also make sure that you make use of all of our material that's available for free on our website. Our books are available for free in e-format. Please make use of them. They are available on our website as well as on Amazon.com. So grab a hold of all our material. We want you to have that. We want you to make use of that. And please feel free to contact us, be it via email or the number that would be available on our website. We would love to pray for you and assist you. Glory to God. I want to thank you so much for slotting in, and I want to ask you, share this message with friends and know this, that God loves you, is kind towards you, and will always care for you. Amen.